Good evening, friends. Today we'll look at the latest news on national education policy. Ministry of Human Resource and Development has developed this national education policy 2020 over a lot of years, and it has taken into consideration many inputs from various stakeholders, including parents, students, teachers. This National Education Policy 2020 is going to revolutionize education in India as far as I see it. Let's look at the key highlights as shown in the PIB website. The new education policy aims to bring transformational reforms in school and higher education. Let's look at what are the key highlights as posted on PIB website on 29 July at 5:34 p.m. The Union Cabinet, chaired by the Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi, today approved the National Education Policy 2020. The new policy aims to pave way for transformational reforms in school and higher education systems in the country. This policy will replace the 34-year-old National Policy on Education 1986. Highlights: school education. New policy aims for universalization of education from preschool to secondary level with 100% gross enrollment ratio in school education by 2030. This point is very important because of the differences between school education like SSC, CBSC, different state boards has caused many variations and school dropouts in various places in India. As I see it, and still India doesn't have 100% literacy rate, which is a very shocking thing. So National Education Policy 2020 will bring 2 crore out of school children back into the mainstream through open schooling system. This is very important point. Though national open school system has been in place for last few years, it has not shown any improvement in the literacy rate, be it education for the grown-ups or education for the school dropouts. Let's see how this will bring the change. The current 10 plus 2 system to be replaced by a new 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4 curricular structure corresponding to the ages 3 to 8, 8 to 11, 11 to 14 and 14 to 18 years respectively. This will bring the hitherto uncovered age group of 3 to 6 years under the school curriculum, which has been recognized globally as the crucial stage for development of mental faculties of a child. The new system will have 12 years of schooling with 3 years of Anganwadi or preschooling. Now, this is a very, very important difference from the old education system that I see. Earlier, we had a 10 plus 2 system, which is schooling up to 10th class with 2 years of intermediate education or PUC education, as they call it in AP and Karnataka. So there was a 10 years of schooling, and then there was a 2 years of preparation for higher education called as PUC. In CBSE, it's called as 11th and 12th classes. In AP and Telangana, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana system, it was called as intermediate education. These 2 years were crucial because they were seen as a preparatory years for the further higher education, be it engineering or medicine or law or any other education system or higher education system that the student wanted to get into. Now, this 10 plus 2 has been completely changed into a system of 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4, which includes additional 2 years before the first class. So, the earlier education system recognized only first class to 10th class, followed by plus 1 plus 2, 11th and 12th class or intermediate first year, second year. Now it will have a pre-schooling 2 years included and recognized in the education system. These can be considered as lower kindergarten, higher kindergarten, or whatever the new system will call it as. But before first class, we will have 2 years of preschooling followed by first class, second class, third class. All these put together will be grouped as first 5 years of education corresponding to 3 to 8 years of age. Now, here it is a very important point to note that 95% of the children's brain develops in this age group. So, it is very important and crucial to see to it that the education system is standardized in these years and the students get the best possible education. Now that the government has recognized preschooling, even the most remote rural child can now be facilitated with such education. The next 3 years, that is after your 2 years of preschooling and 3 years of schooling, first, second and third classes, the fourth, fifth and sixth classes are grouped as one bunch. So this will again, we will see how it will bring in change. Like there is no specific difference that I see here, but probably the number of subjects that the student has to study up to third class, it may be like English, math and environmental sciences and the language that the student will read as a regional language or his mother language or the official language of the state in which the education is taking place. So those four subjects may grow into five subjects at this level of fourth, fifth and sixth classes. Then you have another 3 years wherein the student will have a holistic approach of facing probably the regional language, English, Hindi, which is an added one for South Indians, or a South Indian language for North Indian schools, plus math, science and social. And from the next 4 years, which includes 9th, 10th, 11th and 12th classes in the new system, probably will have the subjects chosen by the student. So the earlier system was meant in a such a manner that at 11th class level, after your 10th class, you will be choosing your specific subjects of maths, physics, chemistry or biology, physics, chemistry, or arts, or humanities or commerce. Now that selection will come up at 9th class level itself. Next point is emphasis on foundational literacy and numeracy. No rigid separation between academic streams, extracurricular, vocational streams in schools. Vocational education to start from class 6th with internships. Again, this is a very important change that we need to see. The vocational education stream in schools is a very important thing. Students will be able to understand how the workplace will be, which kind of skills they need to bring in into themselves in order to face the industry outside. Also, the emphasis on foundational literacy and numeracy tells us that students will be more focusing on reading, writing, listening and speaking skills along with some mathematical skills such as arithmetic probably. This emphasis, let's see how it will be there. Teaching up to at least grade 5 in will be in mother tongue or regional language. No language will be imposed on any student. This is another important point to be noted. Most of the state governments are looking at either imposing mother tongue completely, removing other languages like English, which are very important, or we see some situations like in the case of Andhra Pradesh where only English is emphasized as the language of medium of instruction, which again is a great disadvantage to students. Usually kids, when they grow up at home, they learn a lot of vocabulary in the home environment. This vocabulary consists of close to 4,000, 5,000 words for the kid in his own mother tongue, in his or her, or in their own mother tongue or regional language that they speak at home. Now the school education, once the student enters into first class, and if given a situation like in Andhra Pradesh where they have to face English medium of instruction, the school environment will introduce the student entirely to a new set of vocabulary words that the student may not understand, and this brings in a lot of gap between the students learning at home and learning at school. Whereas teaching in mother tongue or regional language will definitely help a student build upon the vocabulary that he has or she has been building at home, and it will bring in a lot of confidence in them on what they study at school. No language will be imposed on any student is a very important point, wherein private schools or government, state governments such as Andhra Pradesh government are trying to impose English language onto the students, giving them a fake like prophecy that after 15 years or 18 years they will get into a job now if they study in English. Later on it will be useful, which is an utter bullshit. Students studying in their mother language have a more grip on English. I have myself seen many English convent groomed students not able to write even 10-20 sentences. In the final year of engineering, when we are supposed to write a complete thesis, it's the people who studied in their mother language and come up and started learning English as a language in itself and not as a medium of instruction were much better in articulating whatever they knew, in writing down whatever they knew into the thesis papers than those who came from convent schools. They had great difficulty in differentiating between their, he, she, and such several things. So definitely mother language or regional language education up to grade 5 is going to bring in a lot of change in terms of creativity for the students. Next point is assessment reforms with 360 degree holistic progress card. This is very important. When we were back at Kendriya Vidyalaya when I was studying, we used to have a progress report for namesake with fields such as what the student has performed in sports, what the student has been performing in co-curricular and extracurricular activities, including debating or dance drama, etc. Now, once this comes in as a formal tracking system with a tracking student progress card for achieving learning outcomes, when they are clearly stated out, probably the parents, teachers, and the students will understand what a 360 degree holistic progress card is and then inculcate into themselves all the kinds of skills that they need to get in. Next point being a new and comprehensive national curriculum framework for teacher education, NCFTE 2021 will be formulated by NCTE in consultation with NCERT. By 2030, the minimum degree qualification for teaching will be a 4-year integrated BEd degree. Now, this is to ensure that the teaching fraternity itself is well equipped for teaching students properly. But the goals that they have set is far reached. It should not have been 2030. At least, with immediate implementation, it should be ready by probably 2025, 5 years before the planned one. Also, refresher courses can be thought of for teacher education, and then the existing teachers themselves could be trained as in-service courses or as summer courses, and probably we will have a better equipped teaching faculty at schools for students. Now coming to the higher education part, so far has been the school education part. Higher education is something that we study after our 12th class, after our PUC or after our intermediate education, which roughly has your BA, BCom, BSc classical degree courses or BTech, MBBS kind of vocational courses. Let's see what changes the new education policy has for higher education. The first point being gross enrollment ratio in higher education to be raised by 50% by 2035. 3.5 crore seats to be added in higher education. So 35 million seats are going to be added to higher education in the coming years. Now itself, if we see, if there are 100 students who enter school education, there are only 35 students who enter into intermediate education or plus one, plus two, or PUC. That is, they go beyond 10th class, and among them, only 20% are taking up higher education, that is, education at degree level. Among them, a very little or very few actually pass out of degree education. So 50%, in my opinion, in a way, in one way, it's really, really very low figure. In another way, it's a very high figure that the Ministry of HRD has been proposing. So 50% of the of students enrolling for higher education by 2035 could be a possible figure or very low figure compared to actuals if reforms are really brought in properly. But in another case, wherein this higher education becomes costly for the students, once they pass out of probably the 11th class, 12th class, or plus 1, plus 2, or PUC, or intermediate, probably their financials will not let them study higher education. So more incentives, probably vocational education being considered as higher education, ITI or polytechnic being considered on par or equal with your higher education degrees, is going to definitely help get us this gross enrollment ratio, achieve it very easily. But if the current higher education system is kept as rigid as it is now, this 50% by 2035 is a far-fetched dream. The next point in higher education is the policy envisages broad-based, multidisciplinary, holistic undergraduate education with flexible curricula, creative combinations of subjects, integration of vocational education, and multiple entry and exit points with appropriate certification. UG education can be of 3 or 4 years with multiple exit options and appropriate certification within this period. Now, this is a great relief for those who in inevitable conditions have to discontinue their degree. So usually it happens because a girl joins degree education, but at home she is forced to discontinue her education, maybe because of marriage, maybe because of any other reasons, and they have to quote intermediate or 10th class as their educational qualification. Now they can clearly say that they have studied till first year or second year of UG education, because it is going to be appropriately recognized. And also it will help other people who actually have to discontinue their education for any other inevitable reasons. Next point being academic bank of credits to be established to facilitate transfer of credits. This is very important in case of students who get transferred from one place to one location to other location without having to stay back to finish their education or finish the minimum required number of credits. This is going to help us do. For instance, let's take a student studying engineering first year in Andhra Pradesh. In overall, if they have to say study 120 credits in all the 4 years, and in the first year say they have somewhere close to 50 credits that they have to finish, or say 30 credits they have to finish. Now if they cannot pass all the subjects and get 20 credits, the rest of the 10 credits they can achieve upon in the coming years. Probably this point may mean that, or it can mean something else, wherein different curricula or different regulations, different college regulations may finish a certain number of credits after first year or after second year. Probably this will help them balance those credits. So if a student studying in Andhra Pradesh finishes only 20 credits by first year, but whereas a student studying engineering first year in Telangana may have 50 credits finished by first year and need to be transferred to Andhra Pradesh or from Andhra Pradesh to Telangana, the credits can be balanced in such a manner that in second year they give more exams or less exams to balance these credits. Next point being multidisciplinary education and research universities at par with IITs, IIMs to be set up as models of best multidisciplinary education of global standards of the country. This is very important point, and this is very ambitious point probably. Always IITs and IIMs are seen as the top universities in India for higher education, and the worst thing to happen there is that the student coming out of an IIT or an IIM, maybe it's a general statement or very generic statement, but they are taught or they are trained in their subjects, and they often fail to understand humanities, they often fail to understand other nuances of education. But this multidisciplinary education and research university, MERUS, is going to change the entire paradigm. They may bring in better students, better faculty that may come out of these universities. So in any which way, these are the point being they are going to be at par institutions than IITs and IIMs itself is a very ambitious thing. in planning. If they come out to be true, it's going to help us really change the education, higher education environment in India. Next point, the National Research Foundation will be created as an apex body for fostering a strong research culture and building research capacity across higher education. This is very important because of the current research trends. If we see any university's research in Shodh Ganga, it's either like a built-in model of existing research papers or some research that doesn't even have any application or any benefit for the society. Probably National Research Foundation, from its very initiation, should think of national interests, should think of research that actually helps apply and improve Indian society, unlike the research that happens today, which may be very far-fetched from what should actually happen, very sidetracked from what actually should happen. Next point being, Higher Education Commission of India, HECI, will be set up as a single overarching umbrella body for the entire higher education, excluding medical and legal education. So Higher Education Commission of India is going to replace AICTE for engineering and the higher education related other bodies that are present. HECI to have four independent verticals: National Higher Education Regulatory Council, NHERC for regulation, General Education Council for standard setting, Higher Education Grants Council, HEGC for funding, and National Accreditation Council, NAC, for accreditation. Public and private higher education institutions will be governed by the same set of norms for regulation, accreditation, and academic standards. This brings in probably an end to UGC and AICTE and NAAC, NAC. So probably this is going to bring in a good change. Let's hope for that. Affiliation of colleges is to be phased out in 15 years, and a stage-wise mechanism is to be established for granting graded autonomy to colleges. Over a period of time, it is envisaged that every college would develop into either an autonomous degree granting college or a constituent college of a university. Again, I don't see much difference in the current system and the system that is being proposed. Probably the number of years of phasing out may have changed, but this doesn't bring in anything new. Already, even if the college is associated with a university, it is behaving like an autonomous in certain levels, and it is behaving like a constituent college of a university already in certain aspects. So let's see how this new rule will change the scenario. Other points from this national education policy are: an autonomous body, the National Education Technology Forum, NETF, will be created to provide a platform for the free exchange of ideas and use of technology to enhance learning, assessment, planning, administration. Very good point. NEP 2020 emphasizes setting up of gender inclusion fund, special education zones for disadvantaged region and groups. This again tries to fill in the gaps that are created because of our societal norms. Hopefully this will bring in a positive change. A new policy promotes multilingualism in both schools and higher education. National Institute for Pali, Persian and Prakrit, Indian Institute of Translation and Interpretation to be set up. Now this is a really good and positive change. Let's see how it works out. But definitely multilingualism at level of degree education is a positive call, because studying in our own language gives us a more understanding, a better awareness of our existence, of our society, of our culture. Probably this should help us better our education system, particularly higher education system. National Institute for Pali, Persian and Prakrit will definitely help us look back at our inscriptions, our literature from pre-first century era, and probably it will definitely help us look our past and history with a positive sign. The center and states will work together to increase the public investment in education sector to reach 6% of GDP at the earliest. Again, this is a very positive point. Unprecedented consultations, NEP 2020 has been formulated after an unprecedented process of consultation that involved nearly over 2 lakh suggestions from 2.5 lakhs Gram Panchayat, 6,600 blocks, 6,000 ULBs, 676 districts. The MHRD initiated an unprecedented collaborative, inclusive and highly participatory consultation process from January 2015. In May 2016, Committee for Evolution of the New Education Policy under chairmanship of late Sri T.S.R. Subramanian, former Cabinet Secretary, submitted its report. Based on this, the Ministry prepared some inputs for the draft National Education Policy 2016. In June 2017, a committee for the draft National Education Policy was constituted under the chairmanship of eminent scientist Dr. K. Kasturirangan, which submitted the draft National Education Policy 2019 to the Honorable Human Resource Development Minister on 31st May 2019. The draft National Education Policy 2019 was uploaded on MHRD's website at MyGov Innovate portal, eliciting views, suggestions, comments of stakeholders, including public. Yes, I have seen through these developments, and the organizations that I am associated with perhaps have sent their suggestions for the education policy, both the draft policy as well as the initial consultation itself. Thank you for watching this video. More on the new education policy in the coming videos.